What is the architect step in the Safe for DevOps Health Radar? Please note that everything that I'm going to tell you and that I'm going to show you is under the copyright of Scaled Agile. The Scaled Agile framework is a framework, which means that it is sort of a toolbox and you can take out of this toolbox whatever fits your needs. So use it as a toolbox. In my previous videos, I showed you the whole Safe for DevOps Health Radar. We talked about hypothesize how ideas are flowing into this process from the business, but also from the customer side, and they are transferred into epics with a hypothesis statement. With these epics, we are going into the step collaborate and research. There, we are going to analyze the real customer needs. We are going to interview the customer. We are doing some market research and we are going to update the business model which lies behind these hypotheses. And after that, we are going into the architect step. Let's have a look what we are doing here. In the architect step, we are going to take these epics with the hypothesis statement and we are going to define the minimal architecture which is needed to prove this hypothesis. So why do we need to have this minimum architecture? Because we want to enable us to continuously deliver value to the customer. And we have this epic and this hypothesis statement. When such a hypothesis is true, we want to continuously deliver value to the customer and not start then to build up a continuous delivery pipeline for that or to fix all the technical debt. How do we continuously deliver value to our customers? We do that on one side with the separation of deployment and release. And this is one of the fundamental concepts which we have in DevOps. The act of deploying something is when we bring the compiled code into production with a feature toggle off. This is a deployment. The act of releasing something is switching a feature toggle on in production. This is releasing something. By separating deployment and release, we are able to continuously deploy our code into production. So that's why we need to separate deployment and release, because this enables us to continuously deliver value to our customer. As architects and also as developers, we need to focus our architecture on testability. We need to think about how are we going to verify what we are just building. This is architect for testability. And for that, we need to have proper tests, but also proper test data. But not only that, what we also need to do is architect our system so that we can test it properly. And we do that by having loosely coupled architectures. These are small components which we are creating, or small microservices or small services which serve a single purpose and which we can test. And the best way to test something like this is going over the API and test it over the API. An architectural style which you can use for that is the microservice architectural style, where you are building small microservices, and preferable you use also containerization for that so that they run separated, each one in a container. You also need to architect for releasability. Usually you have a big system, like the green one over there. In this green system, you have different components, microservices or services, like the gray one, the red one, and the blue one. Now, what you want to do is have separated the deployments and the release of each one of these components. This enables you to have different deployment and release cycles for each one of these components, services, or microservices. You can see that over here. For example, the gray one is one that has a release, for example, every 2 weeks, and the red one, they have just a release on demand for some security issues. And then you have the blue one, which has roughly a release every month, and the whole system is released, for example, every quarter. This is how you architect for releasability. You also need to architect for operations. You need to take the operational needs into consideration when you are architecting as an architect or as a developer. What does that mean? It means that when you are architecting, you need to think about how will I operate this in production? How are we going to operate this thing? How do I make sure that I get all the data out of the production system so that I can monitor and operate this system as efficient as possible? So that I don't need to log in into the production server and do some fixes there or some investigations there, because we don't want to log in into the production system and do stuff in the production system directly. To do that, we need a good telemetry and logging system. So we need to get all the data out, which is not only the application data, but also business data is needed, because we also want to prove the hypothesis. Therefore, we also need the business data. So all the data which is needed needs to be logged out into a logging system so that we can build up a very good telemetry. But also the feature toggles, which I talked about, will enable us to quickly also switch off some features that are not so good. This also improves massively the operability, because with that we are able to continuously deploy to production with the feature switch off. We can switch on some features for some of the users so that we already can see how our system behaves in production. And we also need to architect for fast recoverability. So we need to have a plan. When something happens in production, how can we recover from a major incident, and how can we analyze such a major incident so that we can recover as fast as possible, so that we are able to make sure that business continuity can be assured. Of course, we also need to take security into account when we are architecting. And we do that by using threat modeling. There's a very good article down here by Martin Fowler about how to do threat modeling. Of course, you need to do threat modeling for internet-facing applications, but you also do need to do this threat modeling for internal applications, which are only for internal use. Also there you have some threats. You do the threat modeling by first of all identifying all of the threats that can come into play with your application. Then you are going to analyze what are the potential attackers of your application. And after that, you are going to analyze what are the potential attack vectors that these attackers can use to attack your application. After you have done that, then you are going to address these security concerns that you have just come up with. One important thing is do this threat modeling with some security experts of your company, because they know the best all of the threats, the attackers, and also the attack vectors. So what is the output when we have done this architectural step? First of all, we have a so-called solution intent or a solution blueprint or a solution design. You can call it whatever. It is sort of an idea how we are going to architect this minimal architecture to prove this hypothesis. And of course, we have now a good set of non-functional requirements. Non-functional requirements are the ELTs, so availability, usability, reliability, and so on. And as you just saw, we covered some of them already, like the releasability or the testability. So these non-functional requirements need to be tested. And of course, these non-functional requirements apply to every user story of our backlog, because non-functional requirements are a constraint on the backlog. Let's have a look at the assessment. Architecting for continuous delivery involves applying just enough intentional architecture to assure policy compliance without sacrificing product development flow, to ensure solutions are loosely coupled, and to continuously pay down technical debt. So now you are going to rate your team, your agile release train, or your product, or whatever you have, or yourself, about the efficiency at architecting for continuous delivery. You are sit when architecture is monolithic and fragile. It is difficult to change and involves managing complex dependencies across many components and systems. You are crawl when architecture is predominantly monolithic, but some applications and systems are loosely coupled. You are walk when architecture is mostly decoupled but doesn't allow release on demand. And you are run when architecture is aligned around value delivery and with few dependencies across components and systems. And you are fly when architecture is built for release on demand and operability. You can see again, architecture is an important step on the way of building a system. As architects, but also as developers, we need to focus on how are we going to operate this system when it is in production. And we also need to think about how are we going to test this system and to verify that it really does what it should do. And of course, it is essential to not over-architect this system, to come up with the minimal architecture which is needed to prove the hypothesis. This is how we do architecture for continuous delivery. And with that, we are at the end of this video. Please leave me a thumbs up if you liked this video, and don't forget to subscribe to this channel, because I will create a video every week for you.